Hello, everybody, and welcome to Cinema Savvy. I'm your host, George Aldridge, and tonight, the Infinity Saga Retrospective carries on with the one, the only Thor Ragnarok, directed, of course, by Taika Waititi. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the channel. I'm your host, George, and joining me for this very, very special video is going to be Theo and Neel. We are, of course, here to talk Thor Ragnarok, one of the best editions in the MCU, getting into things very, very quickly. And I love to put people on the spot in these videos. Now, if you've been watching the series, I'll throw a horrible question that I haven't told anyone about. So I'm going to actually jump in straight away. You two, I'll go with Theo first. What's the funniest part of this film? Let's just go straight to it.
The funniest part, I think, the best part, is Anthony Hopkins when he is as Loki and he sees Thor and he's like, oh, shit. Like, that is just absolute timing gold. Like, that is absolute magic. I love that.
That is a really good one, actually. I think I love the play and how the score from the Dark World is essentially parodied in this, and they cut to the singers, and it's such a piss take on the second film. It's very funny.
Yeah, they're all amazing. I was gonna go with Get Help, but I always get attached to what we do in the shadows. Little reference when he talks about, you know, what this is what you get when there's like three vampires huddled up together. And I was there like, oh my God, it's a reference to that. One of the best TV shows if anyone's been watching that, let alone the films. But these aren't the only bits of comedy we're going to be talking about for this film. This is, of course, the funniest Marvel film, one of the best Marvel films. But we want you guys at home to comment along with us tonight. Let us know your thoughts on Thor Ragnarok. Let us know your funniest scenes, funniest characters, funniest moments, anything. Not even if it's funny, even if there's things where it's a bit of heart or jokes that don't work, let us know that, because this is one I've been looking forward to so much, because I had a very different experience watching this for the very first time. And of course, I'm going to get to that in a short while. However, I'm going to ask you two both, if you can remember your first viewing of this, if this hit you straight away as the sort of iconic film it now is.
Yeah, I remember seeing this when I was at uni. I remember going into it, obviously knowing I'd seen Hunt for the Wilder People. I know exactly what Taika like. You know what Taika's about. So you're just hoping it would be such a departure from, you know, the sort of bogged downness of the Dark World and even the first Thor as well. Like, I just way more sort of attracted to this film in general rather than those two, I think. So I just remember seeing this and just thinking it was a bit of a breath of fresh air, to be honest, to be able to see like Chris Hemsworth, you know, comedic talents be leaned on rather than you know, him having to pout at the camera every 40 seconds, really.
Yeah, I saw this in cinema. I think I didn't see it as soon as it came out. I remember it was a fairly quiet screening. Lizzie and I had gone, and I wasn't that impressed by it. I think there was just so much hype around it. I wasn't a huge fan, and you know, several watches later, I'm a much bigger fan. You know, I watched it last night, and it was fantastic. I think it's one of the best MCU films, and Hemsworth being used, as you say, like for his comedy chops, just like they really put, because he's been kind of funny in some of the films, but not that funny. He's usually like quite brooding and quite serious, you know, a hammer wielding angry god. But now he's a bit more, slightly more jovial, I suppose. But yeah, his talents have really been leaned on, and I really love their chemistry between him and Bruce Banner. I think those two really bounce off each other really, really well in this film.
Yeah, I'm actually with you on that. The first time I watched this, I didn't hate it, but I was like, I was like, this isn't Thor like I've seen him before, like the old films. I was like, and this also is really not what I expected. And I had a very awkward experience. It was half term, a lot of kids out, a lot of stuff being thrown, me getting aggravated but not saying anything because you don't want to be that sort of weirdo that's kicking off at a cinema when there's like eight people in there. So I had a very awkward experience. And then I think I saw it about 6 months later. I picked up the steel because I always did. And I was like, oh, I wasn't really keen on this. And I hadn't been keen on Homecoming. So I was very much not off the Marvel radar. So I was like, okay, Infinity War and Black Panther are coming soon. So I'm going to be invested eventually. And I was. And then rewatching this pre-Infinity War changed everything. I was like, wait, this film isn't just good. This film is ridiculously good and funny. And this is one of those few experiences, I don't know if you guys have it often, where, you know, one of my friends always said to me, you don't watch a film once until you've seen it twice. One of my friends has said that since I've known for about 10 years. And I always get it when it's the films that, you know, you'll watch a film you like, you watch it again and it's crap. Or you'll watch one you don't like, you watch it again and you're completely 180. Like, whoa, this is so different to what I remembered. And Ragnarok sticks like that for me. Now, every time I get the chance to watch it, I will take that chance because I love it so much. And I think I'm not saying the whole thing comes down to one man, but it is safe to say that Taika Waititi is the reason, not the fact that this film works, because it clearly is. It's going to be the first Marvel character to get fourth solo film. And, you know, I know they kind of said politely, you know, we do trilogies and they can pop up in others, but Ragnarok is almost, I'm not saying a reboot, but Ragnarok was, to me, in my mindset, Marvel, like, okay, something didn't work with The Dark World. Well, we know what didn't work with that film. Go check out a video on that. And I reckon after that film, they probably sat back and thought, we need to do something to this character. And I think that's where they started playing into the strengths of the actors, started making creative decisions. I'd imagine Guardians of the Galaxy was a big thing at the time that may have influenced them saying, we want to go for a certain direction with this film to utilize on Chris Hemsworth's talents. But Taika coming into this is probably really one of the best things Marvel's going to have long distance. When you look at directors that not necessarily leave Marvel, that sounds horrible, but Taika's career is a lot bigger than Marvel. Not to sort of shit on Marvel, it's a humongous property. And I even think he's potentially bigger than Star Wars. He's won his Oscar for writing Jojo. And I think he's directed where we have not seen the potential he has. Sorry, not potential. We have seen his potential, but we know that there's an incredible run of films coming. And I think Ragnarok really helped bring it to that main audience. And personally, he's one of the MVPs of Marvel Studios right now. And even as a character too, playing Korg.
No, yeah, I completely agree. I think if you look at Marvel now as a complete sort of landscape, like you can see the chance they took on Taika Waititi with taking an indie director like that and it paying off just ridiculously well for them. Like Kevin Feige could never have imagined how well this has gone down. And then you look, they've taken that blueprint and they've moved it on. Like they've got Chloe Zhao now, and like by all accounts, like what she'll do with Eternals will be unbelievable, you'd imagine. Like Guardians of the Galaxy-esque, introducing us to new characters we've not seen before. And Taika just did, he did exactly what you said. Like he absolutely rebooted the character completely. Like I think it took such a long time for them to actually realize what Chris Hemsworth was good at. Like he is a solid dramatic actor, but he is so much better as a comedic actor. Like his timing, especially with Tom Hiddleston and alongside Mark Ruffalo as well, it just works. And like why Taika's like improv stamp is all over the film. Like you'd be forgiven for thinking they rolled up on set and just started rolling, like without a script. Like that's how it comes across. And that's just how his writing is so effortless, isn't it?
I do find it quite interesting that he's a director who has done something different with the MCU, but he's stuck around because there's certain directors they've gotten rid of who they've perhaps not liked their vision, or there's something about them that, excuse me, didn't work. Like Edgar Wright with Ant-Man and Scott Derrickson for Doctor Strange 2. But it's definitely paid off. Like he's done an incredible job with this film. And what's interesting is he's moving on to, like, he's doing Thor 4, and he's also potentially doing a Star Wars film as well. So that's kind of like he's very much becoming embedded in Disney in the same way that Jon Favreau has been. I think that it's good that he's still got that indie sensibility about him. He, like, yeah, as you say, that there is this improv throughout it, and it feels like there's a bit of an indie sensibility within this film. Obviously, it's a big budget film, and technically, obviously, it's not an indie film, but there's something about it, and I feel like it's him putting his personal mark on it, which I don't feel a lot of directors get a chance to do with certain Marvel films. He's done it with this, and so many of them are brought in just as maybe a bit of a guiding hand. You don't really see any personality within the films that we watch in Marvel. Like, they're all very, very good, but I think this one in particular kind of stands out because I don't know why, but they did something so different with Thor. It must be to do with Thor 2 and seeing how well Guardians did, doing something a bit different and sort of off the wall. It's worked really, really well. And I can't wait for Thor 4. That's going to be fantastic.
And one thing I wanted to add, actually, I'm sorry, I didn't put this on the schedule. Are you both familiar, I'm sure you both are, with the Team Thor short films that came out around the time of Civil War and this? That,
yeah,
it was, mockumentary is my favorite genre of comedy. I think it's, when it's done right, nothing to me is funnier. And of course, what we do in the shadows, not just the film, but the series is a massive hit and is very good. But when those, I mean, us as Marvel fans knew that Thor wouldn't be in Civil War, we all knew it. And you have the general people at home, like, where is Thor? Where is Hulk? And I remember when these shorts started coming out, and it was like, it was his mate Daryl, and I was like, oh, they're all in Australia, so they must be filming the new Thor film. And they were amazing. And I should have known that heading into this, that of course it's the same director, but it was a tease of what's to come and how they were going to start to switch up the character. And I think with this one, I remember seeing, I think it was before the trailer, that EW magazine cover where it was Thor with the short hair, and everyone was like, oh my words, this Thor's lost his hair. And that's a massive part in the film, kind of. But that was when you knew that this is a complete reboot. And I think fair play to Taika for going with it as well, because I think there'd have been a lot of directors, no matter their roots, that would have sort of, I don't know, this may sound horrible, not feared the sort of the corporate world, but I can imagine a lot of indie directors being so grateful at the chance to do a big film, they wouldn't try and change anything. They'd play it safe and be like, this is what we've seen and I'm going to keep it this way. But it seems that Taika came on and he did absolutely what he does best. And he switched things up. He let even the actors have some of their improv as well. And the behind the scenes videos, you always see them talking about Taika Waititi. He is almost the star of the film. In fact, he was able to get people like Kate Blanchett in as well. I wouldn't say she's your typical Marvel actress. And even looking at the next film, Christian Bale, there is no way he signed on for that film because it's Marvel. He signed on to Thor Love and Thunder because he wants to work under Taika Waititi, and he's just wonderful. And the more I've seen of him, his interviews, his mannerisms, and even some of the themes which I actually want to speak about later on in this film, he's not just, you know, people think he's a funny guy, but he's a very smart director. And when he looks at some of the, sort of the history as well, what he puts in this film, it's very reflective of modern culture as well. And that's hit me more on sort of the recent years, is some of the stuff he does put in there. And I think he's incredible, and he deserves everything. And with this film as well, he didn't write, well, I believe, all the scripts. I believe that he sort of obviously let them do improv, but there was already a script in place before he came on board, and he followed that and put his own spin on it. But the fact that Love and Thunder is going to be completely written by Taika Waititi is, and again, looking forward, I know we're talking about Ragnarok, but he's just incredible, and he's worthy of his own segment, because I'm excited to see what he does. And we're going for you, Neil. The fact that he's done Star Wars, you know, we saw him direct The Mandalorian. He did one of the best episodes of that. And then Disney's given him his own Star Wars film for the future. And we know that, you know, aside from what he's filming, I think he's got another indie film coming out with Michael Fassbender. It's a football one. I've forgotten the name of the title, but he's kept himself very busy. And he's certainly, to me, one of the most interesting directors working today. What I wanted to mention, sort of following Taika, is let's talk Thor, because it is his film. He's the lead character. Very much times you just feel sidelines to Taika Waititi and me being personal, but I think this is Hemsworth's best performance of all the Marvel films. I think he's great in some of the other ones before, and you get these moments of comedy, certainly in the first Thor film when he comes to Earth. It's that very awkward sort of coming to America vibe, which he was great at, but going off what you both said, I don't think anyone's utilized Chris Hemsworth properly. Now, I haven't seen 2016's Ghostbusters, but I believe he was apparently one of the best things in it. And again, that was him in a comedic role. And I think you can say a lot the fact that they then wrote Men in Black International, but to get him and Tessa Thompson back together, they left out the key ingredient, which is Taika, and that film was dreadful. I do not recommend anyone to watch that. But Hemsworth in this, I think, very much Captain America-esque. When you get to Winter Soldier, if he wasn't already one of your favorites, he would be, or thereabouts, after this film. I think that's how much it changed him.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I think, and that obviously a lot of it comes down to Taika, and obviously him giving Chris Hemsworth that creative license to sort of play around on set and sort of lean into what he is better at, like in general as an actor. And it's like what you're saying, maybe Taika even saw that Ghostbusters film. Like he is one of the best things about that by a mile. And that was the first time I'd really seen him before. Oh, well, he's so much better at sort of being loose on set, and like, you know, that sort of loosey, sort of easy, like improv comedy, which is what a lot of it is. Like, he's got some of his lines in this are great. The when Loki's tied up and he's talking to him about when Loki turned from a snake back into a guy and stabbed him, like, that is such a great, like, improv. It's such a great delivery. And like, it never fails to like not make me laugh. It's absolutely brilliant. And there's so much of that. Even you know, things that we've seen a million times of someone throwing something and it rebounding and hitting them back in the face. We've seen that a million times, but his delivery of it is so good. And it's like, it is absolutely, as much as obviously Taika is stamped all over this film, it is absolutely like Hemsworth's film. Like, he absolutely burst out of the shell of the bleached eyebrows and all sorts that had come before. And it just it enabled him to hit the heights that he needed to.
I forgot about the eyebrows. They were horrendous. I remember watching the first Thor film thinking, what the hell is wrong with his face? There's something wrong there. I don't know what's going on with this. There's just so many moments that he shines in this, and I think it's one of his best. I don't think it's his best performance. I would say a future film is his best performance in terms of the MCU, but it's definitely best... It's definitely possibly the best Thor film, and I think Hemsworth just gels with the character so much more than we've seen before, because he's kind of, it's almost like he's let loose, whereas before it's like he was restrained and held back. But Taika has kind of, you know, let him do his own thing, and that bit with, about the snake is phenomenal. Like that, I will never not laugh at that. I was live tweeting along with it last night, and it was just one of my favorite moments. Yeah, he's very good, and I don't think I've seen him in a comedic performance before either. And again, when you said George, I've not seen the 2016 Ghostbusters, but yeah, I've heard he's fantastic in that, so I definitely want to see him in that. I'd love to see him do more comedy, and there's just, he's kind of there are a few actors like him who are seen as like action or just good looking or what have you, but there's so much more to them. Like, I feel like him and people like Ryan Gosling and people like that can do more comedy and they'd be phenomenal, like so good in it, because they're not taking themselves as seriously as we've seen them take themselves in different roles. So I think if Hemsworth does more comedy, I think it will really work out for him. But I'm happy seeing him do action as well.
Yeah, no, that's a good point for Hemsworth, actually, because I wanted to bring up, I always bring it when I can. Rush is one of my favourite films of all time. Massive Formula One fan. And playing James Hunt, I'm not going to get into F1, but that's not, to me, that's not an easy role for anyone, for F1. And I remember watching it, I was like, that's James Hunt. It's not just Thor with shorter hair, blonde hair. I was like, that's James Hunt. And he can do drama, he can do action, and now we've seen the comedy. And I mean, there's always the battle of the Chris's, who's the best Chris in America, let alone Marvel and all that stuff. But I think this is truly one, because when he does need to do drama in this film, there's not as much of it, of course, as previous ones, but he's still... does that drama with it. And I think there's a conversation to be had. I think it's just something we're all pretty aware of, that a lot of people can say it's easier for comedic actors to move into dramatic roles than it is for dramatic actors to go into comedic roles. I think that's been a sort of saying that's been around for a while. And because I've mainly seen him in action, I was kind of like, I don't know if he's more drama orientated or comedy. And I think the more we've had of Hemsworth over the last few years, the more I just enjoy him in everything. But I just wanted to bring up Rush because he's amazing in that film, as is Daniel Brühl, another Marvel character, Baron Zemo, of course. I think I probably brought that up as a rant in Civil War, no me. However, one of the things I wanted to mention, because we've got all the great comedies, but a key underlying theme of this film is still carrying on, I guess, that Thor arc that we've seen from the first film through to this one, and I guess even Infinity War and Endgame, is that sort of, I would say, like, it's the weight of becoming king, that, you know, he is a prince in this film. And, you know, he's go back to his opening scene in the first Thor film, and he's all being arrogant because he's about to get the throne, and obviously it's all taken from him and stuff. And this is the film where, of course, you know, they do switch up the ending of Thor 2. We'll get to that, because it just come into the amazing scene in the theatre. It was a big thing to me for them to drop Loki being the key villain. I know this kind of coincides with the pair of them, but at the end of Thor 2, you're like, okay, Thor 3 is going to be Thor versus Loki one final time, and the winner is on the throne of Asgard. I'm so happy that the opening, I would say 15 minutes, disavows that from being a thing. I think that's when you knew that this film's going to go in a different direction, that, you know, Loki sent Odin to not just any care home, it's the care home from the South Park series, if anyone watches that. Shady Acres, which we see getting destroyed, which is one of the best Easter eggs I'd ever seen in my life. I was like, I'm surprised that passed Marvel in absolute truth. I don't know, maybe they didn't know about South Park.
Maybe they didn't notice it.
And that's why I think it's a Taika thing again. It's up there with the Gravestone and Winter Soldier for me. But you know, by the time he gets into the film, Thor is king of Asgard, and I love that subplot that we knew we'd get there one day, but it's him having that responsibility and the maturity to do it. And I like the fact that we still get his core story arc in this, that he's still finding himself and he's on this pathway to what we don't know. And I think getting that sort of final moment, and I think pre-Infinity was definitely worth mentioning as well, that it sets up obviously what happens in the opening scenes, but Thor being king of Asgard was something they needed to get right. And I think they nailed that too with him.
Yeah, I think, and like what you say about his sort of dramatic element still being there and sort of the weight of being king on his shoulders and like everything that's gone before with the like loss and things like that and grief. Because even the bit when just before they do get help, like there's a really good like jump into that dramatic scene when he's like, oh, Loki, I thought we were going to travel the world, travel the universe and battle everyone together. And like that's such a departure straight away, and he can move from dramatic to comedic just like that. And then 20 seconds later, they're doing Get Help, completely forgotten they've had. But that's just how good Taika is at sort of like embedding of different you know, themes in there as well. But then what you say about him being king, it's like we always had to get there, and it's like such a, because it is quite a warm film when you look at it. It's obviously like bright, it's colourful. And then we get that bit at the end and you're thinking, that is like, that's nice. He's finally got there. And then bang, you realize, oh shit, this sets up Infinity War. Like this doesn't have a happy ending. I just think it's so beautifully like woven. I think it's great.
Yeah. Him becoming king at the end is kind of slightly undercut when they're looking at Asgard and Korg is kind of talking about, oh yeah, it'll be fine, the foundations, yeah the foundations, it just blows up, oh you'll never get that back now. it's just such a great moment, and like it's one of those things where there are some films where the comedy is too much and the balance is completely off, whereas this, there's part in it, there's comedy and there's a really good balance between those two. And that moment is fantastic, because you don't want it to be like, it's a great moment, but you don't want it to just be about that. It's they said that, excuse me, they said that Asgard is a people, so it's about Thor, but it's also about the people that he's leading as well. So they kind of show all of that together, and that bit just cracks me up a lot. His path into becoming king is very well done, because there is a moment, I forget which film, but it's Odin who says, I have a son who doesn't want it, and I have a son who wants it too much. I think it might be Thor 2, might say that in, but I forget. And it's just so interesting that he does eventually become king, because that is his rightful place at that time. Obviously, that changes later, but it's done so well, and there is something about Hemsworth's portrayal of Thor that shows how much of a fantastic leader he can be, obviously now that he has become the person he is. In the first film, he would not have been made a good king, but there's been that sort of path of progression to who he is now, and it's very well done.
Yeah, no, exactly. And I think we were sort of Thor. To me, there's no Thor without Loki, and obviously Tom Hiddleston is, you know, once again, the quote, well, he's the god of mischief, isn't he? He's getting his own series coming soon. Aside from Avengers and the first Thor film, this is my favorite Loki film, because we finally get some maturity in his character development. And I do like Loki. I know he does have his fans, but I get very sick and tired of the, aha, Loki is going to betray me and no one saw it coming. And oh, look, he planned the betrayal of the betrayal reaction. And, you know, it's absolutely fine, but when it gets to a character, you know, the end of Thor 2, you kind of knew something was up. You always knew that Loki was being mischievous, he was doing something, and even up to his death in Infinity War, well, I guess we've got to say asterisk death now, don't we? You know, we knew that he obviously wasn't going to bow down to Thanos, but what I love with the story arc in this is that, to me, this is where he fully becomes a hero in truth, that he goes from being that power-hungry guy to just allowing, you know, he goes back to Asgard with all the people, with the revolution, and we get that great moment where he's still on those mannerisms. He wants to be seen. He's got the statue, but I think this is a film where I think Taika handled him best, and because it's Loki, you have to include the "oh, he's going to betray you all along" stuff. And I like the fact that they handle that with comedy, that Thor is aware of it this time, and that Thor knows exactly what he's going to do. And I think their balance with each other is great. And the fact that, from a comedic standpoint, I'm not going to be horrible. I'm not going to say Tom Hiddleston is not funny. You know, this is Hemsworth film, but when there is comedy moments, Tom Hiddleston is great in this. And I think the one that probably gets the best out of everyone is, of course, in the arena when Hulk obviously grabs Thor, and it's just that Loki moment where, you know, he jumps up, and even before then, when Thor like what points is like, "look, it's Loki," and Loki just shits himself because it's Hulk. Tom Hiddleston's so good at that stuff, and I think this is where I change him. This is the film I probably actually enjoy Loki the most as a character, more so than just Loki being Loki. And the pair of them, I think Get Help epitomizes their bond, and for the first time I see them as brothers, and this is where it feels like it is two brothers on an adventure with each other. And I think Taika nailed that.
Yeah, I think he nailed it so well that I think. And obviously, when we see his end in Infinity War, or the end of the Loki that we've seen all along, or whatever, before we get to this new one, I think that's going to be so hard for someone else to pick up if you have to put them two in the same room again, because like their entire arc together, like it was built so perfectly up to that moment, up to the moment that we would see them come face to face with Thanos in Infinity War. Like the arc for me between them two is just beautifully complete. Like, I do think that's I'm not massively warm on the first two thoughts, but I think that's one of the things that they actually did well. And I think that most of that does come down to Hiddleston and Hemsworth. Like their chemistry on screen together is just, it's great. Like even where, like, especially that scene in the lift is probably like, if you're taking comedy out as well, like that's probably one of the best scenes in the film by a mile, just because the way they bounce off each other is just great. And like what you say about them using Loki the way they have before, like, it's just so great of Taika to literally have the words in the script, like, "oh, brother, you're so..." Because it's like Taika just basically being like, "look, we're not going to do this again. We've done this a million times." And to have him found by Korg as well, it's just, it just undercuts everything Loki thinks he is, which is great.
He's portrayed really well by Tom Hiddleston, to the point that from the first time we see him in Thor to... when he's killed off in Infinity War, he's killed a lot of people, and we still love him. We still love seeing him. We still love him in the films because of his portrayal, because he's got that very cheeky sensibility where it is very much epitomizing the mischievous side of his personality, and it's done so well by Hiddleston throughout every single film that he's in. So I can't wait for this series. I was kind of against them doing a series after, you know, after he had died, but obviously this is a different version, and we'll get into that in a future video, I'm sure. But Loki is very, very good in this. That scene in the lift is fantastic. And I do like the fact that he's serving a purpose whilst also kind of being important to the plot. It's one of these things where there are times when he's in it quite a lot, whereas in this film he's not in it as much. It's definitely leaned towards Thor a lot more. They're not relying on Hiddleston to be as fantastic as he is. It's more a Thor Hiddleston film. Hemsworth film. But with Loki there, he's definitely become a smaller supporting role in comparison to previous films, I think. But yeah, he's fantastic in it.
Yeah, and I think the scenes of Tom Hiddleston, it's one of the favourite bits, is sort of bringing Odin into it as well. Not just Loki playing Odin, but obviously we get Odin sort of passed away on screen in this, which is very poignant that they obviously go to Earth to find him. I what might bring up Doctor Strange. I love the fact Doctor Strange is in it. He's still very much a new character to Marvel at this point. And I think there was a very sort of wink when you mentioned, "hey, you didn't see Doctor Strange? Well, here's a couple of minutes of this guy. If you haven't seen Doctor Strange, go watch it. If you have seen it, well, you know, you're going to see him in Infinity War." So I think that was Marvel being sort of Marvel with the, you know, it's like the comic history. Chuck a character in there we all know for a couple of minutes. It doesn't impact the plot, but it's a really great little scene. And I like that stuff. But what I love with Tom Hiddleston is the... when you get Odin's death, the pair of them sat, they're obviously in Norway with the whole Norse mythology. I love that stuff. If you guys remember that first trailer where that whole scene looked like it was going to be set in an alley with Hela in. Mm. And so you can tell it's noticeable green screen. I think they probably didn't know where they wanted that to be set, but I love the fact they went with that sort of landscape direction that's did it away from the city, away from New York. And also that pays homage to the mythos that are in comics. And even when Odin passes away, you can tell that Loki's, you know, he might have hated his father and been a villain and kidnapped him, but deep down Loki does care about him. And I think it's some of those scenes as well where Loki is quite genuine and you can see that character coming out of him that, you know, he is, I guess, loyal to the throne. I hate using that term, but I thought he was great. And when you get all the stuff with Hela and everyone else, I think he really grows into it. But just off the Odin stuff, it's Anthony Hopkins. Obviously, you can't really say much more about him. He's pretty much great in everything. And if he wants to have a laugh and do a comedy, he will. But if he wants to do a drama and go get Oscar nominated, he'll do it whenever he feels like it. And I think in this, even those short scenes on Asgard, we get that sort of comedy stuff from him, which I love. Again, I know it's Loki playing him, but the whole scene with the Loki statue, the play on the screen, the Matt Damon, Liam Hemsworth cameos, and Neil's cameo. I remember at the cinema, I don't know if it's the same for you guys, that you know, you go watch Interstellar and then Matt Damon pops up like, whoa, it's Matt Damon. I didn't know this was going to happen. And then you get to Thor Ragnarok, it's like, wait, is that Matt Damon? Like, is Matt Damon in this film? And that scene in itself is just incredible. But I love the whole concept of this was Loki ruling Asgard. It wasn't this deadly serious starting wars left, right, and center. It was just him chilling. You know, he's got his grapes. He's got the women around him. I absolutely love that stuff. And you can tell Anthony Hopkins is probably liking that as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Anthony Hopkins just, I mean, he can literally do what he wants. Like, he turned it down originally, didn't he, before he read the script. And he was like, oh, that it's, it is, if anything, like, it's a great end for Odin, isn't it? Like, it really is a nice end for him. Also, like, Anthony Hopkins getting to, like, you know, do some comedic, get his comedic chops out as well, which is great. Like, that's my favourite moment of the film. I think it so perfectly encapsulates the next hour and a half of what you're going to see. Like, the moment you see, like, you see that and you see Carl Urban run in and he gets there late, and, like, the moment Thor pretends to... that he's going to crush Loki's face with the hammer. Like, it is great. And obviously, I didn't notice. The first time I noticed it was Matt Damon, but I completely glossed over the Sam Neill and the Luke Hemsworth the first time. And it wasn't until I'd rewatched it that I was like, oh my God, that is actually, like, that is such a loaded cast. And, like spoilers, but, I mean, it feels like they might be back again for Thor Love and Thunder, doesn't it? So we might see them again. Who knows?
Yeah, I think they have said that at least Matt Damon's coming back for the fourth film. So that'll be interesting. I remember reading that he was going to be in it, and it was just, it's one of those, like, moments. It's like, you don't need Matt Damon in your film at all. It's just like, you know, it's going to be good. But then when he was in it, what he did was fantastic. Yeah. So I love that. Anthony Hopkins was great. If you follow him on social media, he is very funny. So I'm glad he's got to do something funny on screen. So I feel like we don't see that enough of him. Maybe Michael Bay thought he was funny in the Transformers film that he was in, but it was shit. but yeah, he's very good. It's a very brief moment, and the way he passes away is very well done. It's handled so well. It's like his time. He knows his time has come, and he kind of has to leave it to those two to bond together and defeat Hela. But yeah, he's very good. Like, he gets a minimal screen time. I know that there was some other stuff that they shot. I think there was sort of stuff at the retirement home or him homeless or something like that. I remember seeing some behind the scenes images, but obviously that wasn't used. He's great in this, and I'm glad that he wasn't in it too much, because again, that's something that I don't think has been done too much in other films, but it's like it completely passes the torch to Thor and sort of to Loki, but obviously more to Thor. So it's done very well.
What I love with him as well, this isn't really meant to be funny, but I love that he knows it's his last few moments. He's like, by the way, you've got a sister, and she's the goddess of death. See you soon. I love that. I know it's not meant to be like comedy, but it's the way he delivers those lines as well. Like, the goddess of death. Hela, she's coming. Yeah. It's like, what? and you know, the fact that his death ultimately creates the storyline for Hela, that she gets locked out of the Eternal Prison. And we get the amazing scene where that she destroys Yolnir, which I remember in the trailer, everyone was like, whoa, that's going to have repercussions, which led to one of the greatest scenes to me in cinema history. Not Portals, but the scene in Infinity War. Of course, Portals is still up there. Well, it's right up there. Should we talk Hela? No, let's save the villains in. Let's talk about one of the heroes, because we get some great ones pop up. Let's talk Hulk. We mentioned him earlier. I love Mark Ruffalo. I think he's so perfect as Bruce Banner, and emotion captures the Hulk. He's one of, you know, it's so easy to say this for so many people, but I think he's one of the best additions to Marvel. The fact that he came in late with the Avengers and he made it his own in his first film. I didn't have the faintest clue that Hulk was going to be in this until that first trailer. I don't know if it was public knowledge and I was too stupid to read into it, or if it was kept a secret. But when Hulk appeared in that trailer, I was like, oh my word, like, it's Planet Hulk, it's World War Hulk, it's all this stuff, we're going to get all this stuff. And I just loved Mark Ruffalo in it. And it's, I guess, until Endgame, it's the most you get to see him motion captured as the Hulk, where he's developing a bit of a persona. And we do get these tidbits, we get some really funny stuff. But I think Mark Ruffalo is just wonderful as Bruce Banner as well, that he can be very funny, but it's that awkward humor. You know, it's that, I'm not saying it's a mockumentary thing, but I think it's very hard for actors to play awkward comedy, because sometimes it doesn't work, or other times to go so far over the top it can't work. But the actor needs to strike the perfect balance of awkwardness, and Martin Ruffalo has it. I don't know if it's the scientist vibe, but it's just those short moments, you know, where he's like dressing him up as Tony Stark. And again, some of the types of, you know, just don't get angry, don't think of it. And then it's like green smoke, giant Hulk faces everywhere. And I thought Mark Ruffalo and Chris Hemsworth was a duo I didn't know we needed. And we had, I guess, tidbits of it in the first few Avengers films. But in this film there, it's literally like another sort of, it's like sort of Bill and Ted. Like just two dudes on an adventure, you know, running around the city with Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah, which is mentally, you told someone during Thor the Dark World that we'd be getting Jeff Goldblum melting people with a stick in the third Thor film. We'd be like, what the fuck is someone talking about? But it's great. Like, I love that entire bit where he dresses him up as Tony and he's like, I need a disguise. He's like, you're already in disguise. It's like, you're not the Hulk now. And even the stuff between Mark Ruffalo and Tessa Thompson as Valkyrie, like when they're like, do I know you? Like, that is great stuff. Like, he does play that sort of oblivious comedy quite well. Like, the joke's on him, but he has no idea. Like, that works well between the two of them, I think. And then again, like, Taika just allowing them to play and bounce off each other works well. And obviously that scene where they're sat down on the stairs has spawned 1,000 memes, hasn't it? Like, the is it though is just... is it gold? Is it gold?
Yeah, he's very well cast in this. I think from Avengers to... well, throughout his time in the MCU, he's been fantastic. Like, Mark Ruffalo kind of plays this clearly disturbed doctor who has something wrong with him. But you would, if you didn't know already, then you would never actually know. You can just tell that there's something wrong there. And I think he plays that really well as mixing with the comedy in this film. Yeah, the bit where they're sitting down is a fantastic bit. And how, when he finds out he's been the Hulk for, is it 2 years, 2-3 years? I forget now, it was something like that. It's a really, really good moment. It's played really well. And it is it's really shocking to see that he was the Hulk for that long. Because obviously he goes in and out of it and what have you. And there's another bit where he says something along the lines of, where it's like this, I'm trying to stay calm on a planet that's designed to stress me out, which is such a great line. And there's another bit where he goes, like, his veins go a bit green when he says weird, like in that really strange way. That was a terrible impression of him, but you know, it's fine. Mark Ruffalo is wonderful. I'm a big fan of him. I think he does the drama well, but I don't think he gets too many dramatic moments in this film from what I remember. It's a lot more comedic than he's ever been before. And the bit where he jumps out of the ship and hits the bridge. Dear Lord, what a joke. He just like smacks it. Fantastic joke. I'm laughing thinking about that now. I might have
it's the sound effect. Again. It's like a windscreen. So I mean, something hits a windscreen, isn't it? That sound effect. It's just amazing.
Yeah. It's just a clunk on like a big piece of glass, and it's just wonderful. The fact that there's like a giant wolf just behind him as well is great.
Yeah, it's sort of like breezes past. Really quickly, Marco will be watching this. Long time watching the channel, known in many years. Massive fan of. He was the biggest Thor fan pre Ragnarok. I think that's a fair comment to make that he does enjoy Thor: The Dark World. Just while on this, whilst we started the series, he did a tweet saying that he'll be watching because Thor's the best ever. Going off what you mentioned, Theo, the Izzy though. The fact I can send the Izzy though to someone talking that Thor's the best character ever epitomizes how it's become full circle. It's just, and the thing is, on the rewatch yesterday, it's not like he lingers on it. It's like a millis. It's so quick. Like Izzy though, and it cuts, and you know, like that spawned one of the gif of gifs for like film stuff. And Ruffalo is amazing. And you mentioned Valkryie. Let's talk Valkryie as well. Tessa Thompson is amazing in this. I think she's, I don't want to say underrated. I think people realize how great an actress she really is, but getting to see her do her comedy stuff in this at the same time as just getting Creed films where we're getting the dramatic stuff from her too. I think she was genius casting to this. And the fact that, you know, I guess a big thing worth mentioning, looking back at this as an entire saga, there's no Jane or Lady Sif. We know that Natalie Portman fell out big time with Marvel. We know she's coming back to the next Thor film. And I believe she said all it took was a 20-minute meeting with Taika Waititi and she'd already signed up. Now, that could mean many things. I think the answer was probably, hey, Taika wants you to be in his film, but you're also going to become Thor. And if you're not already rich, well, yeah, you're going to get richer. So those three things were probably the big sway. But I'm going to be brutally honest. Sif and Jane are not missed at all. I know there's a really awkward one of the only jokes I really find funny, but I don't mind it, is the awkward girls on the street, like, oh, we're sorry Jane dumped you. And you know, I knew they were going to make a joke about it, and I love the fact that it's just funny that they just came to Earth. The whole thing's like that they're taking selfies in the streets and Loki's just casually chilling there, the guy that tried to massacre New York and the planet, and you get jokes like that at the end of the film, like, could I go to Earth? And it's just amazing. But Tessa Thompson, I think, helped steal this film. And the chemistry with Ruffalo, with Jeff Goldblum, with Hemsworth, with everyone, she's such a wonderful addition as well. And I'm glad we got to see her in Endgame because she was missed in Infinity War for me.
Yeah, she's an absolute, like, she's just an absolute star, isn't she, really? Absolute star on screen and all. Like, it's quite rare, isn't it, to see an American actress do a British accent. We always see it the other way around. And it's so rare to see an American actress, well, absolutely nail a British accent as well. Like, you can't really... You don't hear it slip at all, really. But what you're saying about Jane and Sif as well, it's like that's neither of Jamie Alexander or Natalie Portman's fault. They're just badly written. They're just poorly written characters. They're underwritten. They're so underwritten. It's like, it takes someone like Taika Waititi to come in, or like, well, any half good screenwriter really to come in and like give those characters what they really deserve. And I'm really glad that we'll get to see Sif back, and we'll get to see Natalie Portman actually get her teeth into what will be like a massive role rather than, you know, like a sidekick role, which is great. Like, you want to see one of the best actresses on the planet go absolutely hell for leather. Like, there's a reason that film has obviously been able to, I know we're going a bit off tangent talking about Thor Love and Thunder, but there's a reason that film has been able to attract the likes of Natalie Portman back, Christian Bale. Like, that film is, it's obviously, like, it seems like absolute gold to the people that have read it so far. And that'll be great. But obviously, going back to Tessa Thompson, yeah, she's amazing. And like her arc as well, going through Infinity War, obviously, well, we don't really see her, but then into Endgame, is absolutely great. And like where she's left at the end of Endgame as well, it leaves so much open for her character. Mm. And like, it's strange in a film that's so dominated by Chris Hemsworth and Tom Hiddleston and Mark Ruffalo to look at Tessa Thompson, Valkyrie, a character who we've not seen before, and be like, oh, wow, I really want to see like loads more of her. Like, you want to see her in a film. Like, I'd love to see her and Brie Larson's Captain Marvel together on screen. I think that would be great.
Yeah, she's very, very good in this. Tessa Thompson is written very, very well and shows he plays it well. It's one of these things that a lot of the time in films, we kind of have to see, like, like a girl who is either really tough or a mess or perfect or something like that. And she's kind of a lot of that all in one, like she's layered as all humans are. And I think that's something that's really, really written well for that character. And I don't think we've really seen I feel like Marvel is kind of lacking with the female superheroes. Maybe obviously recently it's a lot better, but up until that point, there just wasn't very many good ones. Black Widow is great, but that's kind of it. Yeah, Tessa Thompson is very, very good. I think chemistry with her and everyone throughout this film is fantastic, but in particular, her and Ruffalo just seem to bounce off each other. It's just really, it's completely bizarre. And then that carries on. They sort of have a little interaction in, is it Endgame? They sort of see each other again when he becomes Smart Hulk. Tessa Thompson is very, very good. I think it's a shame that Men in Black International didn't work out, because a lot of people thought that should have been a lot better because of those two together. But I think you kind of have to have the combination of everyone behind the screen, behind the scenes, as well as people on the screen as well. So this is where Taika Waititi knows what he's doing, and he balances all the characters really well. Like, we see enough of every single character, every primary character, that we don't need to see more. It all feels very well balanced, and that includes Tessa Thompson's Valkryie.
Yeah, and I think even the comments of aside, I really want to bring Men in Black again, but I'm too ashamed to do it. Again, it's you know, Sony. They had a chance to do Men in Black crossover with Jump Street 23, which would have been probably the greatest crossover in history. I'd give them another shot. If they said we're going to do a Jump Street crossover, but it's going to have Tessa Thompson and Chris Hemsworth, I'd actually be willing to say, okay, you know, you've got me at least for the first 20 minutes. But even the drama stuff, the fact that she's an alcoholic in this, I know that Marvel doesn't dip into themes like that often, but you know, she was a Valkyrie. You get that great scene with Tom Hiddleston where, you know, he sort of looks into her memories, and some of this, not just the visuals in this film, but the cinematography is beautiful at times. And that whole short sequence, you've got the music playing, you see her watching her friends die, you've got Hela killing them all. That is all the character development you need for her. It doesn't need to be this overly elaborated, you know, X, Y, Z happened. You get everything you need. You get ambiguity before of why she sort of didn't care about Asgard. And when you get it drilled down to the basicness of it, that just thought that it's another petty family squabble and I'm not having a part in it. And that's the reality of it. And not just to get to current politics, a lot of royal families are like that. But I think Tessa Thompson is a wonderful addition to this. And I can't wait to see her in the next one, because we are getting Jane back, we're getting Sif back, we're getting Valkyrie back. So, and Jane, of course, Natalie Portman and Tessa Thompson were both in Annihilation together, which is an unbelievably underrated film. I'm excited to see them all on screen. I don't know if they're going to make any weird jokes about Thor having a love square now. I don't know if they'll try for a love triangle or something ridiculous, but I'm excited to see what Taika wants to do with them all. But
I think they'll make Valkyrie gay. I've seen
that discussion. Have they already said it, actually? No, you're right, because I feel like I've read that, actually.
Yeah, I mean,
they said something about Queen.
Yeah, it would absolutely be the wrong decision not to do that. That's so obvious, like, and there for them. Like, I think it's definitely what you've got to do. You have to go down that route, I think.
And as well as a side piece of that, actually, talking about stuff, Marvel, I know they said that cameo of the, oh, I forgot which of the Russo brothers was in that Endgame scene. Like, oh, it's the first game Marvel character, and it's there like,
well, Joe, you think?
Yeah, and I'm there like, come on, man, like, don't claim you're doing all this like deep equality stuff in film when it's for 2 minutes. But they want to go with Tessa Thompson, absolutely. I think she'll play it wonderfully, and I trust Taika to write it. And the title of the film, it's not like Blood and Thunder, it's Love and Thunder. So you know there's going to be themes like that. So I'm excited. I'm very excited for that. Before I was gonna, yeah, let's say the best of us. Let's not get to Jeff yet. Let's talk Hela and Scourge. When Kate Blanchett was cast, that was unbelievable. That first trailer was not in a weird way, but you know, I think a lot of people joked that if they're gonna get killed by Hela, they wouldn't mind because it's Kate Blanchett. I'm firmly in that category that she is amazing in this. Doesn't need to be the most developed villain at all. I know that Marvel have had a villain issue, but I really, really like her as a villain in this film. I think she's terrifying. I think the costume is outstanding with the whole sort of horn stuff coming out the heads. I know that she's the literal goddess of death, but she just spawns knives every 30 seconds. I love all that. And I think sometimes there's nothing wrong with a two-dimensional villain. I think when it's an interesting one, one you enjoy, and one that's got a great actress in a great film, I think you can let it slip compared to a Ronan the Accuser or, you know, all ones like that, whereas Hela is just phenomenal. And she's so good in every one of the scenes. Kate Blanchett steals it, and getting Carl Urban with her as well as Scourge is just, he's an unbelievably talented. So I absolutely love him, but I adore her in this. One of my favourite Marvel villains.
Yeah, I think what you're saying about like her not being that fleshed out, like it works because you know exactly what she's about straight away. Like she is absolutely ruthless. And when she walks in and just starts killing people from the off, really, doesn't she? Is it the Warriors? Warriors 3, Warriors 4? I can't remember.
Yeah.
She just walks in and she just like, this is how powerful I am. Like you guys are just nothing to me. She's absolutely great, and it works. Like her star power as Kate Blanchett works. Like the reason like we say Ronan doesn't work and stuff like that is because like we know it's Lee Pace, but a lot of people don't know it's Lee Pace. Like underneath that, he's covered under so much. It's like there's nothing he can do in that situation. If it's not in the script, he's not going to be able to do it. Whereas Kate Blanchett is just able to just like riff and be like look like she's having a great time as a villain, which is sort of in a film like this, which you know its first port of call is comedy. Like that's what you want to see from the villain, isn't it? Someone that's reveling in just how shit they are.
she's very very good. I'm a big Kate Blanchett fan. I think she's great in a lot, and I think it might be the first time her and Carl Urban have worked together since Lord of the Rings, so yay. They do quite a lot with her. I think that you say she isn't that well developed, but they show enough of her that we understand her motivation, whereas a lot of the time it's just world destruction and kill this, kill that. But for her, it was primarily taking over Asgard because that's where she was getting her powers. And what we saw from like the flashback with Valkyrie, Odin described, and the mural as well, that was enough. Like we saw, that was plenty of character development for me. I mean, we don't really see that much of, yeah, like Ronan the Accuser or Malekith or the other forgettable villains where, you know, that they just kind of want world destruction and we don't know why. Like there's no reason for it. It feels like there was reasoning to what she was doing. Kate Blanchett plays it very, very well. She didn't really have very many funny moments, but she's kind of, this can't be sort of, you know, it's a Marvel film. It can't be an outright 100% comedy. So it does have to have that villain aspect where it's someone who is serious and who is serious about what they're doing. So yeah, she does play it very well. And Carl Urban is great. He's very, very funny. The bit where he's running along the bridge or he's using that exercising thing where he's supposed to be like summoning back Thor and what have you. It's very, very good. Like I don't think they do get like some scenes together, but I think he's better sort of on his own. Like Carl Urban is great. Like see him and the boys, fantastic. He's just pretty much amazing in everything that he does.
Yeah, him as Scourge is amazing because I remember they said that Carl Urban, it's not a hype train, but you know, Lord of the Rings, Dredd, Riddick. He's an actor that's been in a lot of great things pre-Thor, and I remember like Carl Urban's going to be in Thor. I was like, I am down for this. And then you get, there's so many wonderful lines in this one, but you know, this is Dez and this is Troy, and together they destroy that. The way he says, I was in Midgard, a place called Texas, it's you know that he's having the time of his life. And I'm not saying the boys would have changed anything, but you know, had he have done this after the boys, maybe he'd have got a couple more minutes. I don't think he would have needed it, but anytime he is on screen, he's great. And he has a fully fledged character arc as well. You know, we get his death, and even Hela is kind of politely gutted that she's got to kill him because you can tell she liked him too. But you know, these are my stuff. And it's everything that's become memes on his, and he's great in this, and such a welcome. And the shake weight as well. It's just so funny, the whole thing. You know, I would never complain about getting more Carl Urban. I will put him in any film, and he will work in it. I just love everything he does. And Thor's just another one of, you know, he got to work with Taika. And I think, and it sounds very weird, because this was obviously filmed in Australia as well. It's being able to and this sounds horrible, not Get Locals, but you know, you've got like Carl Urban's from New Zealand, you've got Kate Blanchett as well. It's nice that it's not just boring Americans, as in that's a technically racist term, but we're getting other people that normally do a Marvel film, and even Love and Thunder again shooting in Australia. It's just so much going to be, but I love Scourge in this. I know not everyone likes some of that comedy stuff, and I don't care that in the comics he's this brutal executioner. He's amazing in this, and I guarantee you a boring two-dimensional executioner would have been a waste of Carl Urban, let alone screen time.
Yeah, I can't imagine Carl Urban would have taken it, to be honest, had it been like just that, you know, two-dimensional, you know, axe wielder like we've seen in Game of Thrones or something like that a million times. It's like what you want is something different, and that's just what this film completely delivered. And then from like Taika's point of view as well, like you say, well, like you said, Neil, where like it has to be a Marvel film, so it has to have those Marvel beats in. I think he does that. He weaves those in so well. Like when you get the Scarlett Johansson message from Ultron, and that's what turns Hulk back into Banner. That is so, so well delivered. Or when Hela is walking through the Odin's treasure room, whatever, and she sees the Tesseract, and she's like, "Oh, that's pretty cool." Like you just get. You get those beats that slowly drop in, like, every bit of the way. Like, Taika's not, like, too fussed about the post-credit scenes, you imagine. Like, that's not his remit. That's not what he's got to do. But to, like, drop those Marvel beats in along the way as well. And to keep, like, you know, like, what we said about Mark Ruffalo and Bruce Banner together, where it's, like, he didn't get his second film. So, like, his arc has had to be played out through Ultron, Ragnarok, and the two final films, which works so, so well. And Taika is a massive part of that. And then obviously he is also a massive part of, if it's not for this film, you probably don't get to a point where James Gunn is like, oh, wow, like I do want to merge these two together. Like, please take my Guardians and do whatever you want with them, because like, I know they're safe in your hands. Do you know what I mean? Like, it just works. He just molds everything together beautifully. I just don't think this film misses a beat, to be honest.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think it's all very, like I said before, it's all very well balanced. And the thought of Thor and Star-Lord pissing each other off in whichever film they're going to be in next is like one of the most incredible thoughts. It's just it that's going to be very, very funny. Like the end of Endgame, where he was just kind of undermining his authority, was fantastic. But yeah, with Carl Urban, I must admit, I think I forgot that he had sort of that sort of change of heart and sort of an arc, and that he died in the end. But I completely forgot about that because I've not watched this film in a while. He's very, very good in this. Like he's very good in everything. But I don't know how familiar I was with him before this. So I was kind of aware, but not seeing certain things. Forgot that he was in Lord of the Rings because I'd only watched his films once or twice. And I've not seen the Dread film that he's in as well, but obviously since then he's George, not a fan. He's been, so he's this, his Star Trek, The Boys, and just so much. So it's great to see more of him, and just to see how well he plays dramatic and comedic in one role.
Definitely. I will say, add Dread to your list. It's the greatest performance by a chin you may ever see. that means I was going to talk about Jeff, but let's actually jump in something else. We mentioned Hela. You mentioned the Moors on the Wall. This is something I don't really know much about till recently. A lot of people talking about this film, and I think it's a very indigenous film. Obviously, Taika Waititi's roots within New Zealand are very much Maori. You may be familiar. I don't mean to sound bad, but a lot of people think of like Maori warriors, sort of that kind of stuff, where it's not just warriors. It is a people. It's a race. And what this film to me really well explores, it is very much that modern history. And I'll say this is as relevant as it's going to get in England. When Hela destroys all the monuments, and she says that amazing line, it's like Odin, you know, I can't even remember it. She basically says, you know, took everything and ashamed of it, kind of hiding the past, showing people a different past. I forgot her line. She says it so well.
Yeah, she says, what did she say? She says, he's like, loves having it, but ashamed of how he got it, isn't it? Something like that.
That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then that said, that is not just a reflection of a Thor film. That is a reflection of the society we live in. There I go saying society again. That hit me quite hard recently because obviously I didn't know much of it. There's a lot of essays online, and obviously with Taika, he's also Jewish. So when he did write Jojo Rabbit, which he won his Oscar for, very personal to him, as is this film. I'm very happy that Marvel, I'm not saying Marvel wouldn't allow that to get put in, but you can tell that's something very much Taika wanted in there. And I think it worked so well on a reflection of that film and also of Odin. You know, when we did the first Thor film a couple of weeks back, you know, they mentioned some of the stuff that Odin's, you know, took stuff before. And I'm not saying this was ever going to tease that. It was never a part of the plan to go down that route, but it just adds to those little things. And I just love that concept of Hela, that he'd locked her away, he kept her a secret, and he was ashamed. And it just adds more to the mystery of his character, because we all know that sort of empires and kingdoms, they're not built out of nothing. We know that stuff does exist, and it's a stark reminder to the world we've lived in and modern history, because some people don't like it when you say stuff like that. I'm not going to get into that too much, but I couldn't do this video about bringing that stuff up, because that's something, again, that's Taika, and I wonder if we'll get bits of that in the next film too. On a really weird tangent, I'm sorry, I'm going from talking about sort of dark history to talking about Jeff Goldblum now. I don't even know where to start. So Chris on the channel, he doesn't like Thor Ragnarok. I'm going to call him out for that he's wrong. However, he does love Jeff Goldblum in it, and I've never been able to unhear this, that he calls this final form Jeff Goldblum. Like, it's like Jeff Goldblum became... There is no further Jeff Goldblum performance than Thor Ragnarok, and that stuck with me for so long. I liked Goldblum before this film, and I end up loving him after this. I end up seeing his jazz orchestra live in London, which was amazing, because it was just Jeff Goldblum being Jeff Goldblum while playing the piano. Unbelievable man. We're getting him back in Jurassic Park. I think this has had a bit of a renaissance and absolute truth with him, and I'm all here for it. I want more from him. I love him. And the Grandmaster. You know, the fact we basically have a Charlie in the Chocolate Factory reference. If we didn't already want him to play Willy Wonka, if they really want to reboot it again, you know, this was the audition. You know, I don't even know where to start with him. He's just amazing. You want more from him, and we got more. We got a mockumentary about him on Earth afterwards. I need more of him. Him and Taika, what a duo. Perfectly balanced with each other.
It is absolutely, it is perfection, isn't it? And like, Chris is absolutely right with that. Like, you can't, If you're Taika in that situation, you want to give him notes. Like, what are you going to say to him? Please, please be more Jeff Goldblum. Like, go as far as you physically can. I think his chemistry with, I forget her name, but the police officer from Hunt for the Wilder People, who is his right-hand man, that when, like, she's handing him the melting stick, and he's like, what are you handing me this for? Like, I don't need this. His delivery of pretty much every line in this film is bang on, and it wouldn't surprise me if the entirety of it was completely improvised, because he is that good that he can literally just do what he wants. Like, Thor's just gone through the most like traumatic experience. He doesn't know where he is. He doesn't know what's going to happen. And the first thing he sees is Jeff Goldblum playing the keyboard. It's like only Taika Waititi could put that into a film. Like, he is that. And Jeff Goldblum is obviously that good. And him doing this did spawn a bit of a renaissance. Like, he got that Disney Plus show, didn't he, of him just like, you know, wandering around looking at things. And it's like, I would absolutely watch hours more of the Grandmaster if or even a slight cameo of him in anything else, if he did pop up again. Like, that would be great. What more can you say?
Yeah, exactly. Not really much, to be honest. I suppose this is the most Goldblum-esque Goldblum performance that we've seen in a very long time, because I think, a couple of years before this, or 1 year, was it before this? Was it he was in Fallen Kingdom, Jurassic Park? I don't know if it was before or after this, but he was just like thrown in. It was just pointless. It was boring. He wasn't really, you know, the fun, charismatic character we saw in the first Jurassic Park. Whereas this was just so up his street. It was brilliant. It was quite, I suppose, wacky and out there and a bit odd and a bit strange, just very Goldblum. Like, he's played a lot of these sort of roles, and he seems to be that sort of person as well, which I absolutely love. He's very good in this, and yeah, I don't know what else you can say, really. I'm not really sure what else you can say. He's just awesome. I mean, who doesn't love a bit of Goldblum?
Yeah, I think my favorite part of him is it's the melting stick when it's after. He's like, did he ask him what does it smell like? And it's just
burnt toast.
Everything just. He's like, oh, it's like coming. It's near me, and he's just, you know, give him his own Marvel spin-off series. You know, him and Benicio del Toro, their characters are technically cousins or brothers or something in the comics. So,
I
can't say any more than that about him. I don't even know where to go next with this. We spoke about the characters, and to me, this film is the characters. We spoke about so much of the plot. Let's jump in. Let's talk about the destruction of Asgard. Some people absolutely hate this. I love this twist. Is that, well, it's not even a twist, really, is it? That Asgard is the people. You know, it's the population. It's not the planet. And I've got no issue with the fact that they destroy it. I mean, Ragnarok is the ending of Asgard. That's a natural Norse mythology thing. I think when they announced the slate back in 2014, some people were like, oh, Thanos is going to come to Asgard and take the gauntlet and take the Tesseract, and this is going to be the film that starts the Infinity Saga, blah, blah, blah. Korg's line sums that up perfectly. You know, what we spoke about earlier, and it's like, you know, you kind of the foundations to build it, and then it gets burned up. What a way, to me, to set this up for the future film. Your country or your people are in space in a ship, ending with Thanos' warship just lingering on them. I adore that ending to it, but I also think with it, it's worth mentioning that there's always been a deep theory on it. I actually wanted to run by you guys. Some people think Thanos went to get the stones knowing Odin died. I know that's a pretty deep theory. I know you guys have seen it mentioned. They mentioned how, like, the world would be weaker without Odin. I like that theory. Yeah. I'm not bothered by it, but it's kind of cool in that sense that everything happened after Odin died, that theory could exist if Marvel wanted it to.
Yeah, I think it is cool to think that, obviously, like, he had that much prominence, like, in the universe. Obviously, we know it was his life force or whatever that was keeping Hela back, and obviously she's such a devastating being. So to think that Thanos, like, was sort of clued into that as well would be quite cool. But as far as, like, the destruction of Asgard, I think it's cool, and I think it's a good twist. I had absolutely no idea what Ragnarok meant. So, like, to see that, like, the point of the film was that they actually had to cause it rather than stop it, I think is a nice little departure from what we're used to of the A to B sort of superhero film. And obviously with your entire sort of their entire country being or on the ship at the end, I think that's part of Marvel setting it up for Infinity War as well. Like, they've taken Asgard off the table, so it's like you take that off the table straight away. There's nowhere that Thor can go, like, he's, and then you get his sort of arc through those next two films, which is pretty brutal, isn't it? Which, you know, maybe he would have just skulked off back to Asgard after he'd failed to kill Thanos, something like that. So to take it off the table, I think it was a bold but the right decision, I'd say.
Yeah, I definitely didn't see it coming, but I'm glad that they did it. I think it's one of these things where, oh, they'll just save the day and it'll be fine. No, they blew up the place they were going to blow up anyway. So that's great. And just, I mentioned it before, that Korg's line is just brings it all home. It's wonderful. That is a really good bit. I think it's good to just get rid of it, just see where they end up after that, because it's been such a, I don't know, there's something really boring about Asgard. It's just all so plush and big and nice, and we kind of always see these very big regal places when it comes to stories similar to this. So it's quite nice that they got rid of it and they let Taika Waititi blow up Asgard, and, you know, it's great. I'm glad to see it go. I'm curious to see what they'll do next in terms of, you know, where they go, because they're now, I think they're on Earth in Holland or something like that right now, or something like that at the moment, where like new Asgard is. So it'll be interesting to see what they do with that.
Yeah, because I think is it Scotland? Is it meant to be Scotland or something? Or I don't know, but I think it's a tourist hotspot now. People keep going to the sign. I love that. And even going back to Korg, the amazing bit with Meek is like, oh no, Meek's dead. I accidentally stepped on him. He just comes back to life. It's just amazing. And I can't remember, was Meek in Endgame? I think that's something we have to find out for myself, actually.
Yeah, he's in the, he's playing Fortnite with Korg in the...
Of course he is. Of course.
Oh, against the new master, yeah.
Yeah.
We'll get into the Infinity War switches when we get to that, which is only two videos away. And I guess even worth mentioning, we always speak about the credit scenes. We've kind of spoken about it, that we get the setup for Infinity War. You know, it's so easy to forget that these films, I hate using the dead canon, they're out of order. That we know that Black Panther was obviously the follow-up to this, but that was set straight after Civil War. I really don't care about stuff like that with Marvel. It's absolutely no issue to me because I'm just excited to see these films and I don't care about the placement. But knowing in the timeline that Infinity War happened like 2 minutes after this, I've got no issue with either. And it just helped that wait when that credit scene first popped up. It's like, you know, it's like a reminder, this guy's coming in a couple of months' time for you all to see. So that's a credit scene I loved. And the other one, you know, it's the Marvel comedy one. It's Jeff Goldblum waking up on his planet. I'm sure he'll be fine. Maybe we'll... Could you see him have a cameo in the next Thor film? I couldn't see it in truth, but if he did, I wouldn't be complaining.
Yeah, I wouldn't complain. I think maybe you'd even see him, like, they might bring him out to play a different character. You never know. Like, just as a sort of meta joke to people that are watching it, maybe. Like they did in WandaVision with Evan Peters or something like that. Like, you don't know.
Yeah, the more Goldblum, the better, I say. When it came to, like... Thanos going after the stone, just to go to your previous point, I've not actually heard the theory of, because Odin passed away, that's why he's gone after them now. I've heard it could be more to do with the fact that he knew where all of them were. Like, he just found out where the final stone was, so that's when he like went after all of them in one go, and like quickly got them all, and then did what he did. So I don't know. I don't know why he did it then, but it's curious.
Yeah, I mean, what I will say is that at least he wasn't sitting in the end of a portal staring at the Avengers for like 20 minutes in super slow motion. So I'll leave that bit there. And everyone claimed that there's a better version of him elsewhere, which isn't the case. Stanley cameo, love talking about that as well. One of my favourite ones, not just because they get him in an outrageous costume. You can tell it's not a CGI costume too, but it's the fact that ultimately Stan Lee gives Thor a haircut, and it's a great comedy moment. You know, the fact that the haircut is done abysmally just adds to it, that he's got all the cuts along his head. I absolutely love that stuff. But, you know, especially when we get some of the last few Stan Lee cameos, it's, you never know when they're going to pop up, but when they do, and this is one of those really lighthearted, fun ones, and you can just tell that, you know, I know that he wasn't on set with them for them, but you could just imagine the cast watching it for the first time, knowing that that was a character. They probably knew it would be Stan Lee, but you can imagine them watching it for the first time, saying, oh my God, this is how it was done. I love it.
Yeah, I think it's the best Stan Lee cameo, to be honest. I think it's great because obviously it gives us something like for the rest of the entire film as well, and gives us a great Hemsworth comedic moment of, you know, I am mighty, don't touch my hair, to like, please don't touch my hair. It's great. And it's like, you know, nice for Stanley to have a role that was, you know, part of the story, I suppose.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I'm always here for a Stanley cameo. I know that some people really, really don't like them, but I love them. Yeah, he's kind of, it's funny because he's kind of part of the trimming of all the things within Thor's world that we see. So he gets, they get rid of his hair, they get rid of his hammer, they get rid of his, the Warriors 3, they get rid of Asgard, they get rid of, I don't know, some other stuff, I'm sure, but it's just like so much that they get rid of, and to put Stan Lee in sort of like in the mix, getting rid of his hair is great, and short-haired Thor is better than long-haired Thor, so you know, it's all good.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on that one, and I know we're going to get long-haired Thor in the future, and I know we're going to get ripped Thor in the future, and we'll obviously get to that in Endgame, but character goes on quite a journey from this one onwards. I'm glad they did that. I'll talk the soundtrack very quickly. It's not a great... I'm not bothered by the soundtrack. I love the whole techno aesthetic when it's on score. Mm. What I do love is the Grandmaster Jam, which is, of course, the Jeff Goldblum theme. I don't know if he DJs it himself, but the fact he's just sat there DJing in his tower is amazing as well. And obviously, the main talking point is obviously the Immigrant Song from Led Zeppelin that, you know, I'm not going to say it's about generations. There will obviously be people that know it because of the band and the music. There'll be people like me that know it because Jack Black sung it in the School of Rock, and that's how I first heard about the song. And there'll be, I think, a lot of people that think this is Thor's song, and what a genius song to use, considering the lyrics are actually about sort of Norse mythology anyway. And I just hope that they follow up with Thunderstruck in the next Thor film.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good way to sort of bookend the start and the end of the film as well, isn't it? It opens it and it closes it, and obviously it demonstrates how much, like, you know, the journey he's been on, I suppose, through the entire film, and like how powerful he is by the end as well, which is great. But yeah, I love the techno stuff on Sakaar. I think that stuff's great. Like that whole sequence from when he gets pulled away from when he's talking to Valkryie to when he has his haircut and stuff to the moment he steps out into the arena is great. And yeah, I'd be very disappointed if Jeff Goldblum didn't DJ that. The Jeff Goldblum. Yeah, he must.
I'm sorry. I really like this. I think there's a lot of sort of techno psychological music in this, which kind of like fits with the aesthetic of all the sets and like the colourful designs and all that. I think it goes really well. Led Zeppelin, always here for Led Zeppelin. I think they're fantastic. That song is used well. It's rare that a song can be used twice in a film and it's actually done well both times, because a lot of the times it feels like they've used it once, good, but then they use it again. It's just kind of like forcing it in a bit. But this felt right. It felt really, really good. Like it was really well done. I think the score's a decent one. I don't think it's one of those things where it hasn't exactly got a memorable tune or what have you, track. But if you hear something from it, you'll know where it's from, if that makes sense. Like, it's not got a theme, I suppose, but it's good.
Yeah, exactly. And it does the job from what you want from the film as well. Following that as well, what I really want to bring up, because we're pretty much in now, we always talk about favourite moments. I'm going to go out on a limb. I don't think there's a bad scene in this film, being completely truthfully honest. There may be something, but I think trying to pick a favourite moment from this is going to look like a top 10 video, in absolute truth. But I'm going to go one I've not spoken about yet, which is the one that makes me laugh loud every time. It's the orgy button on the ship with Mark Ruff alone. It's when it starts singing, it's my birthday, and oh my god, it's the woman behind in the ship behind that she, I don't know if she knows that's the button he's pressed. And it obviously results in her dying, but Mark Ruffalo's comedy timing, not having a clue what's going on, and just everything is just amazing. One of my, every year, I don't tweet it on my birthday, but I think I did like two at the last couple of years, and it's Jeff Goldblum, and it's the fact it's his like orgy ship. It's just amazing. Had to bring that scene up. It's right up there.
Yeah, I would love if that was Goldblum's idea as well. Like, I mean, how do you get away? Like, again, you'd have never ever thought like years ago that you would get a Thor film that had like the devil's anus in it and an orgy button and stuff like that. But it just works so well. Like, it's so, so good. And then all the stuff, like, I mean, you could pick up any number of things with Korg, couldn't you, really? Like, I enjoy his interactions with Meek are great. Like, when he first meets Thor and he makes the rock, paper, scissors joke, and then he's the one that sits on Meek and it's like rock crushing scissors. Like, that is just like an absolute genius, I think. And he's just got stuff like that running all the way throughout. It's just magic, I think.
There was a bit where, this is my favorite moment, but they're like, they talk about that ship is like for the Grandmaster's orgies, and it's just like Thor just turns to Hulk and said, "Don't touch anything." So gross. But there is a great bit with Loki where it's factually accurate and it's a joke. He just screams, "I've been falling for 30 minutes," and it's just wonderful. It is very, very funny, and it's so good because Doctor Strange is not here to put up with any of his shit or anyone else's, and he just gets rid of them as soon as there's any sort of threat. It's Loki through and through. It's very good.
Yeah. Really quickly, that Doctor Strange scene, WandaVision. They're pulling the hair out, turning into a spell and a portal. Loved that we got that in WandaVision. Lovely little tease back to that and the whole magic stuff within Marvel. So, Carissa, what else could happen? But no, Thor Ragnarok is, to me, sort of wrapping up, is it in my top five MCU films? I'm going to know in probably 2 weeks' time. But considering to the journey of where I was the first time I came out of that screening, to look at it now, and I'm sat here thinking, do I really watch it again tomorrow night? Do I like hold off Black Panther for another day to watch Thor Ragnarok again? Because it's so rewatchable, it's so fun, and it's just amazing. You know, you can't go wrong with it. And I think it's an absolute wonder. Is it the best non-team up film? I think it's got to be in the argument and the conversation now. But I'm here for it. I'm here for any Marvel sequel that Taika Waititi wants to work on. I'm here for any film Taika wants to work on now. I'm fully fledged, and it's just amazing to discuss it. And yeah, that's my kind of final thoughts. I can't do anything but give praise to it in absolute truth.
Yeah, I'm the same. I just think it was an absolute, well, I mean, Taika probably didn't think it was a gamble, but it's a gamble from Feige and a gamble from Marvel to give him complete creative control, something that they'd struggled with before with like Edgar Wright and stuff like that. So to just give him the keys and be like, look, you know, deliver us what you deliver us, and for him to deliver something so, you know, so balanced on so many levels, and something that, like, you know, elevates the story on towards Infinity War, which is the remit of any director when they take one of these films, but to also give us something completely original that we hadn't seen in the previous, however many we'd had before, 16 or 17 or however many it was. That's just, yeah, again, I would absolutely watch any more. I can't wait for Love and Thunder. I think it'd be great.
Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to watching this again, and I wouldn't have said that after my first viewing. I'm glad I've seen it sort of, you know, a good few more times, and I love this film now. I think it's fantastic. It's probably the best Thor film, but I do love the first one as well. But yeah, this one is, it's very, very good. It's just, as I've already said, it's all well balanced, well written. Hemsworth gets to do a lot more comedy in this than he's done in the MCU before, so it's great to see him getting to do more, something different than we've seen him do before. And yeah, it's just, it's one of these things that they seem to lean in heavily into the comic book imagery of it, whereas they haven't before. They've kind of dialed it down. It's either been set on Earth or it's set on some sort of grim world or what have you, whereas this one, it was just so colourful, so psychedelic, so in your face that it felt like it was the right move for this Thor film. And it's kind of gone in the direction of Taika coming back and them doing a fourth Thor film, which can only be good after this. It's potential top five for me.
No, absolutely. I'm with you guys for all of that stuff. This has been a pleasure. There's been so many great discussions over the last couple of weeks, and there's plenty more on the way. But I think Thor Ragnarok's probably the one when you're going through 23, and, you know, not saying there's films you just like before or films you like before, but Ragnarok just stands out for so many different reasons. And that's been echoes. I absolutely loved doing this video with you guys, so thanks for coming on. But I want to hear from everybody at home. I want to know all your thoughts on Thor Ragnarok. Is this Thor's best film, or is this one of the best MCU films? And just comment some of your favourite scenes, because it's just wonderful. Can't go wrong with it. I absolutely love it. And we need to hear your thoughts. And if you did like this video, if you like this discussion, if you like our other Marvel discussions, hit that subscribe button. We've got Black Panther coming up next, which is going to be coming very soon. Let me just bring the dates up. I'm completely sorry, I forgot that. Yes, Black Panther is coming Saturday, the 10th of April. Be sure to join us for that one. That's going to be myself, Neil, and Tom coming on for that. I'm very much looking forward to discussing that. It's been the first time I've seen it since Chadwick Boseman's passed away, so it's going to be quite a different, I think, experience and discussion, but one I'm still looking forward to nonetheless, because it's a wonderful film. And for you guys at home aren't familiar with the Marvel schedule, if you don't know where we're up to, we're finally on row three. You know, we're on the home stretch now. We've got a couple more films on the way. We're almost at that big one. We're almost at Infinity War. We're almost at Endgame. Still some to get to between now and then, but if you have liked this video, if you like the series, then stick around for that, because they're going to be coming to you in the next couple of weeks. And we've got so many other things happening on the channel. We're near Oscar season. We're in Oscar season. We've got videos coming out thick and fast for reviews. Some that didn't even get nominated for Oscars has ended up getting reviewed because we've been able to see them. So if you like your non-Marvel stuff, obviously you've got them. And if you do like Marvel, then I'm just going to say once again, we've got a Falcon and the Winter Soldier spoiler discussions coming every Friday evening. That series, at the time of recording, ended the first episode, and it was a great first episode. So I'm excited to see what comes next. Maybe in 2 weeks, we might not, who knows, but do join us for that. And yeah, I'm going to bring up some of the places where you can find you guys. Neil, I've got your socials here.
Hello, yes. It's all just Neil's Real Deal, all double E's, because it's a really fun, cool name.
And Theo, I've got your Twitter here, and I've got some of the websites as well for you.
Yeah, just a very generic Twitter name along the bottom. hopefully get a review, probably review Falcon and the Winter Soldier tomorrow, I think. So hopefully get that up at some point over the weekend.
Definitely. Everyone do check that stuff out with us. We've got a lot coming up. Hit us up on our socials, which is far too many. Cinema Savvy on Facebook, Twitter, Letterboxd, and TeePublic. So do check them out. It's been amazing talking to you guys tonight. I want to thank everybody at home for watching. And I wish this could have been another hour, but we just don't have that kind of time. Maybe it'll be one of our other phase three videos. Who knows? But once again, we'll see you on the next one. See you then.